And we're talking about Joshua over the next few weeks. Joshua is a very important part of the Old Testament. Joshua was Moses' second-hand man. And he watched everything that was taking place, and God was with Moses. And as God was with Moses, God will also be with Joshua. When you're reading the scriptures and you're thinking about what God is going to do within the life of Joshua and a country that was in bondage, we were in staff on Wednesday, and I was talking to Justin. I was telling him what we were going to be preaching about. And from Wednesday to today, Justin wrote that song, and he got the band to play with it. So he did a wonderful job talking about Joshua, allowing Joshua to be in his life. And so he did a great job. Let's give him a round of applause. Be courageous. Be of good courage. Don't we need to hear that today? A country that was in bondage. It was in bondage over Egypt. And God told Moses to go to Pharaoh and have him let his people go. God's people. It's very important that we put ourselves under the protection of God. Just as Moses was their leader. Pharaoh had no power over them. God was in control. And when they start going through this wandering experience, we look at how they wandered in the wilderness, and you start looking at that, and what was all that about? And I want to take a few moments to set up the idea of why Joshua was taking over the country. Why is Joshua now in charge? Moses was the leader. He was the one that allowed them to gain them the courage to talk Pharaoh into letting them go. They were in bondage of Egypt. They were lost in bondage. They were slaves to Egyptians, but they were God's people. But Moses heard from God on a mountain and said, "My people need deliverance." And Moses said, How can I deliver them? You tell him, "I am. I am will take care of this." And in our culture, in our country, we need to have that same courage to say, you know what? We are the mouthpiece of God. We are God's people. We can be delivered. What we must do is understand that sometimes we are also in that bondage. It's Egypt represents our lost lives, that we need God's grace. We're in bondage to sin, and we need help. It could be our spiritual Egypt. Some of us are in that bondage. That bondage that we have never been delivered out of God's, out of Egypt's wrath and been put into God's grace. We are stuck in our spiritual Egypt, still in our sins. Egypt represents that lost in bondage. But then we have the Exodus. We have the Exodus. Moses goes in front of Pharaoh and pleads, and all kinds of plagues come upon Egypt. And he cut the sand, he hardened his heart. He would not let them go. But finally, the last plague in him, which talks about the exit or deliverance or the salvation. Said even in the Old Testament, when we look at what God did in the Old Testament, it's a beautiful picture of what God has done in the New Testament with His Son. Pharaoh said no 9 different times. But then he said, okay, if all this stuff, all this plagues, I'm starting to get tired of it. And Moses gave me one last chance. He said, there's going to be a death angel. And I tell you what's going to take place. If there is not a sacrificial lamb, a perfect lamb that is slain, and the blood is put over the mantle and on the doorpost, every male child, every adult male child, every firstborn child would be put to death when the Passover angel comes over. It's a beautiful picture of what Jesus Christ is to us in the New Testament. And what we need to do today, we are brought out of bondage, out of our sin, when the perfect Lamb of God was slain, and the blood that He shed covers us. We are gaining access out of our bondage into peace. The blood of an innocent lamb over the doorpost represents that Jesus is our innocent lamb. That he had to shed his blood, and he had to die, and we had to put that blood upon our life. He became the propitiation for our sin. Moses went to Pharaoh after that, and Pharaoh got mad. He said, "Get out. I am tired of this." So upon a lot of issues, they started going, and it goes to the wilderness experience. The wilderness experience is talking about the spiritual immaturity. You know, the wilderness experience is needed. And we all have wilderness experiences. We all have wilderness experiences that we need to have. You know, the first 2 years of them being delivered out of Egypt into the wilderness, the first 2 years was just God getting to know them, and them getting to know God, and God giving them the Ten Commandments and teaching them what they need to do and how they need to do it. For 2 years, they were getting close to God. So those 2 years, it was important. It was important. The wilderness experience, getting to know God. Have we been in that wilderness experience, that immaturity before God, where we want to get to know God, and some of the decisions that we make continue us in that wilderness experience? And we feel like we're dry, we feel like we're tired, we feel like we've been just wandering around in a schmuck life, and we haven't done anything for God, and we don't even know if God is hearing our prayers. We need to get a hold of God. Sometimes the wilderness experience is profitable. But when we find out what the wilderness experience is for, and we make the proper decisions, then we go into the Canaan. The Canaan is the victorious Christian life. The victorious Christian life. You know, from Egypt to Mount Sinai was at about 11-day travel. 11-day travel. God was wanting to teach them how to build a kingdom and how to have a country and how to love God. And he allowed them for 2 years to have that time alone. And they were fed by God, and they were protected by God, and they were directed by God. God was in the center of their life and gave them everything that they needed to have. There was not another country more blessed than Israel. And they're not. And there's not today a more favored country of Israel. That's why it's so important. The Bible says, "Those who stand, I will bless. Those who curse, I will curse." It is very important to understand this is God's people. But even in God's hand, making improper decisions, God punishes those that he loves. God takes care of them. But you know what? Canaan, although there's spiritual maturity, and that's what Canaan represents, there's also battles in Canaan. Battles. Sometimes we like to be spiritually immature because we don't have to fight the battles that God wants to put in front of us. Sometimes in the low points of our life, and sometimes in the issues that we don't know what to do and the things that are facing us, sometimes we want to turn and run, stick our head in the sand, and we want to play the immature game. But God says, be of good courage. Stand up and fight. You cannot wander in the wilderness forever. For 40 years, a generation did not do what God asked them to do, and they wandered in the wilderness. And Joshua's coming on the scene, and he said, "I will not make that same mistake. I will stand in the face of adversity. I'll do what God wants me to do," because there's a point in a city called Kadesh Barnea. And Kadesh Barnea was where they were getting ready to cross over to the Promised Land. And Moses, he must have been a Baptist preacher because he put a committee together. He put a committee together and he said, "These 12 guys, I'm going to send you over to the Promised Land. I want you to scout it out. I want you to come back. I want you to tell everybody how awesome it is, how beautiful it is. And what we're going to do, we're going to take your motivation and we're going over and we're going to conquer the land that God has already given to us." So these 12 men spy out the land. It's a beautiful, beautiful land. But they've been wandering for 2 years. They've been taken care of for 2 years. Manna, taking provisions, wandering for 2 years, and God has blessed them. They haven't had to fight amongst anything except for themselves. But these 12 men, they go over. It's a beautiful picture. A beautiful land. They come back. And they said, "Oh, guys, they brought the country together and Moses together. And on the mountainside, hundreds and thousands of people were there." And he said, "Oh, it's a beautiful land. Oh, flowing with milk and honey, beautiful landscape, beautiful mountains, but there are giants in the land. And we are like grasshoppers to them. But God will deliver us. God will deliver us. Out of the 12, you know the story. 12 men went to Canaan, 10 were bad and 2 were good. Out of the 12, 10 bad reports. They loved what it looked like, but they were fearful in what they had to do. And sometimes we wander in the wilderness because we know what God wants us to do, but there's giants in that land. There's decisions that I have to do. There's battles I might have to face, and I don't want the battle. I want to stick my head in the sand. I want to stay on this side of the Jordan. I don't want to deal with that because it may cost me something. So they came back and they voted not to go. Two men, Joshua and Caleb, said, "Our God is well able to deliver us out of their hands. Our God has given to us this land. Let's go and possess it." But everybody else, yep, don't want to do it. And it angered the very heart of God. 2 years they wondered to get to know God. And then God said, "If you, country, if you don't follow after what I've already given to you, you will never possess the land." For 38 years, because they did not do what God asked them to do here, they wandered for 38 years. And as I talk to people all day long about why their life is going in troubled ways, what's going on here, what's going on there, they say, "I don't know, it just stinks, my life. I don't know where God is. I don't hear Him talking. I feel like I'm just doing the deja vu life." And I have to say, let's go back. Let's go back to the decision. Where is it that you said no to God? Where is it that God wants you to do something and you said, "I don't want to do it"? That is the point where God says, "I need you. I have given to you. I have provided for you. I have given to you the gifts and the abilities to possess the land." But Israel didn't. And God said, "You will never see the promised land." 40 years later, Moses dies. The generation is off the scene. Two men are still alive. They go into the promised land. Joshua and Caleb. Down the road in about 3 weeks, we're going to talk about Caleb. Caleb being 80 years old. The Bible says he's as strong at 80 as he was when he first looked at the land. God kept him, provided for it, and given him strength. Now Caleb and Joshua are leading the new generation. They led that new generation to a place that only they could dream about. They came to a place that was dangerous. It was going to be hard. But they knew that they could not make the same mistake as they did 38 years ago. And they said, "God made us promises. And He promised me that land. He promised us that land. He said it is ours and nobody will touch it. Let's not be afraid to possess what God has already promised." So often we are afraid to do what God has already asked us to do. Are we afraid? Are we afraid that somebody can hurt us? Are we afraid that Satan can disable us? Greater is He that's in me than he that's in this world. What we have to do is we have to stand and say, "You know what? Somebody may fail me. There could be problems and circumstances, but I have to be faithful to God. Understand that God loves me. And if I'm faithful to God, if I'm going to possess what God has given to me, nothing can stand against me. The gates of hell cannot stand against me. I have to be strong and I have to be courageous. I have to be very courageous because I may be standing alone. People may be all around me against me, just like they were with Caleb and Joshua, but they said, "No, you're wrong. We are well able to deliver. We are well able to defeat. We may have to go against adversity. There may be fights in front of us. We may not have the answers to every step that we take, but God is, When they wandered in the wilderness for 2 years, they were led by a pillar of fire at night and a cloud by day. They didn't know where they were going, but God delivered them. They didn't know what they were going to eat, but God delivered them. They didn't have the idea what to do, but God, in every circumstance, went in front of them. And that's my people. And are we God's people? Are we the children of God? Are we the blood-bought saints of God that has given our life to Christ, that we know that when we die, we're going to heaven? Is that all we get to go to heaven? Well, God says, I want to give you a better life. I want to give to you something here. I want to give to you something that you can't possibly imagine. So if you have your Bibles, turn to Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3, verses 16 through 19. It says this: For who, having heard, rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt, led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not that those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness, and to whom did he swear that he would not enter his rest, but those who did not obey? So see that they could not enter because of their unbelief. Their fear, their unbelief that God would provide for them, it captivated to a point that God, in their eyes, could not or would not deliver them. They were afraid of their father. So that's a little history of the places in the wilderness. But let's talk about the keys to spiritual success. We don't want to be stuck in the wilderness. We don't want to get stuck going around life doing the same old thing for 40 years and fighting the same battle and not growing maturely. What we want to do is we want to say, where am I and what can I do and how can I move to that next level? And Joshua is a beautiful picture of how God's hand is upon him. And he fought through the battles. He asked God to deliver him. And God three times said, be of good courage. Be strong. Do not be afraid. There's going to be things in front of you that's going to captivate you. That's going to cause fear. That you're going to tremble. But greater is he that's in you than the things of this world. What we have to do is we have to look at what we're going to fight. We have to see, well, how am I going to fight? We can't fight a spiritual battle with flesh and blood. We're not going to fight this battle with words. We're not going to fight this battle with guns. We are going to win the battle on our knees. It's a spiritual warfare, and God has the power with every believer to stand within him, to give him that boldness and that encouragement. Whatever you're going through, whatever wilderness experience that you're having, you will not win if you do not put God in the center of the battle. You will be discouraged. You will fail. You will get defeated. It is horrendous. But the greatest thing, do not be discouraged. Because we need to know that God is in front of us. And that we have to have a clear mental picture of what God can do with us. We are not little puppets. We are not little rodents. What we have, the power of God to defeat the things that Satan wants to destroy within our lives. But we have to understand where those strongholds are. We have to understand what the deceptions and what the lies are. We have to understand that is not from God. That lie is Satan. That thing that he's dangling in front of me is not of God. I have to be aware of that, and I have to be understanding of that and be able to fight that off. So what are the keys? The first key is assurance of God's presence. We have to have assurance of God's presence. Let's look at Joshua chapter 1, verses 5 and 9. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I'll be with you. I will never leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. If we are a child of God, just like Joshua, we have to understand that because I have Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit lives within me, he will never leave me and he will never forsake me. I may have to do battle. I may be in a fight that I don't know what to do. He says, I will never leave you, nor will I forsake you. Verse 9, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. The key word there is discouraged. Satan's biggest tool is discouragement. Somebody give me an amen. Is everybody happy? Oh, there's no problems. Sometimes we get discouraged. Sometimes life stinks. Sometimes we're like, what in the world is going on? Why all the problems? Because we get discouraged because we're listening to the lies of Satan. We don't look at the positives, what God is doing. We're looking at what Satan is trying to do, and we focus on the negative. And he says, be strong. Be encouraged. Don't get discouraged. See what God can do. God is with me every step of the way. Assurance of God's presence is important. Not only assurance of God's presence, but the courage for God's challenge. Courage for God's challenge. Verse 6, be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people into an inheritance, the land I swore to their ancestors to give to them. Sometimes, to take ground, we have to fight. Sometimes, to do new things, there's a fight. And sometimes when that fight is going on, it is difficult. There's problems. The strongholds that Satan puts within us is very difficult. We give in a little bit. We give up a little bit. Satan moves further into your life. He starts looking at that deception, that depression, and that discouragement. And he puts a stronghold center into your life. You've already given that part of your life up. There's a void, so Satan takes over that void. And from that stronghold, he starts taking little enemy shots and finds out where there's other weaknesses. And when there's another challenge and another fight and another stronghold and another weakness, and we're so afraid, we just back up again because we're afraid of Satan. We're afraid of standing. We're afraid of fighting. We're not putting God where he needs to be. So we're afraid, so we take another step. And all of a sudden, there's another stronghold. Satan's starting to work again. Sooner or later, another stronghold has given up more of your life. And now you have this issue, and now you have this issue, and you have all kinds of depression issues. You're not strong in Christ. And all of a sudden, you say, I don't even know if I'm a child of God anymore. I don't have any peace. I don't have any comfort. I don't know where God is, because we're not standing the challenge. And we have to have courage that God is going to win through us. But we must stand up. That's why he says, be strong. Be courageous. Do not let Satan have a foothold. Why? It's because every time Satan has a foothold, it's a fight to get it back. It's a fight. I wish I could give a magic pill. Here, take this pill and everything's going to be okay. Take this pill, Satan's not going to bother you anymore. And when you say, you know what, I am going to be strong, Satan knows, you're going to have to be strong. Because if you bow up to Satan, what's he going to do? He's going to bow up to you. He's going to bow up to a point that you're going to say, phew, I don't know if I even want to do this. And when you bow up, you better be on your knees and say, God, I need you. Because I am needing you to take over some strongholds that Satan has put in my life. And I need to be very courageous. I need to be very aware that it's a fight. Our marriage is a fight. Our kids is a fight. Our finances is a fight. Our country is a fight. Our morality is a fight. Our convictions are a fight. And if we give up our morality and our convictions and our finances and our families, guess what? We are taking a step back and Satan is moving in. He's making a stronghold. And we have to stand up and we have to fight. We have to understand why. Because God has promised us. God has been with us. God has delivered us. We have to be strong. And we have to be of courage. And we cannot be depressed. We have to be a man, a woman of God. Verse 7. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the laws my servant Moses gave to you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. You want to know how to get success? You want to know how to be successful in your family? In your relationships, in your morality, is follow God's word. The Bible says, be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law that my servant Moses gave to you. Do not turn from the right or turn to the left, that you may be successful. If I would say this, this is a blank one. How many people want to be successful? Okay, how many people want to fail? We desire success. We don't wake up and say, oh, I'd like to fail today. We want to go to work. We want to get our raise. We want be successful. That's what we desire. It's an inner desire that we have. Spiritually, we should have that same desire. If you want to be successful spiritually, if you have God's hand upon you, obey what God has asked. He said, if you don't turn from God's word from the left to the right, you will see success and prosperity, because God's word will protect you. So we have to have courage. Courage. Yeah, I heard about the hunter. How many of you guys like to go hunting? A lot of hunters in here. There was this guy that went on an African safari, and he came back, and he was all excited. He was talking about all his friends, and he told his friends, he said, guys, look what I got. I have the tail of a lion. Everybody, oh, wow, you have the tail of a lion. I chopped off the tail with my bare hands. The guy that was looking, he said, why didn't you chop off the lion's head? He said, well, it was already gone. So sometimes courage fighting insignificant foes really is no courage at all. We can brag about false success all day long. We can tell people what they want to hear and make us look good all day long. But in the fight, when it's genuine, when there's a trial, when there's a struggle, and you have to face that lion face to face, do we stand up and fight, or do we turn and flee? Courage. Courage is the ability to stand in God's power and to do what he asks us to do. So not only do we have to have assurance and courage, but we also have to have obedience. Obedience to God's word. In our culture today, this one is scary. Do we do what the culture says? Or do we do what God says? Do we stand to be popular? Or do we stand to be powerful? Do we take a chance of blending in and losing our power? Or do we stand up in the very words of God and say, it's not about what I think. It's not about what I say. This is what God says. And we are an ambassador for Christ. We have to be obedient to God's word, not play the game, not cut off the tail when the lion's already dead. Sometimes we have to face the lion head on. Sometimes we have to do some things that's going to be courageous. Churches are going to face some major issues over the next few years. What are we going to do? What are we going to do when it affects you? What are we going to do when your friends say, you go to that church? You hold to that view? And as I said a couple weeks ago, we have to love. We have to encourage. But I want to say this very delicately. The church, because of the footholds that Satan has put into the church, the church has lost its authority and has lost its power. Not because same-sex marriage is approved in the Supreme Court. We haven't lost our authority because of that. The church has lost our authority because we have left the principles of God's word. If the church, if the men and women of the church would do what they're called to do, then we would be a lighthouse into a culture that needs Jesus. But there's more affairs going on in the church. There's more addictions going on in the church. But we are blinded because we want to hide it. We want to cut off the tail, but we don't want to face the lion's head. So what we do is we just act like it's a morality issue. And if they would not try to enter into the church, we would be perfect and pure. And God is saying, if you were perfect and pure, we would be a light into a dark world. The church, we need to have power. We need to understand God's word. It is God who gives us that authority, that gives us that power, that allows us to defeat Satan and take over his strongholds. But until the church stands up and becomes the church that God wants them to be, what is the culture going to do? The culture is going to do what the culture does. Continue to take breath. Continue to take strongholds. And if the church doesn't stand up, and we don't stand up for God's word and do what God has asked us to do, what we as a church across America will do is we'll take another step back. We'll close our eyes. We'll stick our head in the sand. And we'll say, I'll win the next one. And the next one comes, another stronghold. Down the road. And the church will start to say, why don't people respect the church? Why don't people come to church? Why don't people give to the church anymore? Why is the church of no effect? And we're going to blame a culture. But it's really our church. The culture doesn't keep our church from the power of God. God is our power. God has given to us His words. Listen to verses 7 and 8. Be strong and very courageous. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it from the right or the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do, what's that? To do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. It doesn't say, meditate on it day and night, think about it, be careful to pray about it. He says, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Church, we have to be proactive. Christians, it is not enough to know the Bible. It's not enough to be able to quote scriptures. It's not enough just to say what the Bible says. It's not enough to say you go to church. The Bible says, if you know it and we do it, then we will be successful and prosperous. The church must not say, I just go to church. There must be a faith that's bigger than our attendance on Sunday. It has to be something. Meditate on it. Learn it. Obey it. And do it. And then you'll be successful. Then the culture that is anti-Christ cannot infect the church, because the church is all powerful because of God. And He says He will be prosperous with us and give us power because we know God's word. But if we just go to church and the word of God is just some things that we read, words that's on a page, but we don't do anything about them, we're not going to be prosperous. And we're not going to have good success. So what are the three things that we need to do? Speak it. We need to talk. The culture will be against the very words of God because they were against God. They hated Jesus. They're going to hate you. But greater is the word of God. And if we speak it, talk about it, let people know outside of the church that you're a believer in Jesus Christ and God has transformed your life, and give them the word of God. Not preach to them, but to show them. Let me tell you what God's done within my life. Give them testimonies, give them victories, and let God work within your life. We need to speak it, and then we need to meditate on it. Not just read it. You know, somebody says, I've read the Bible through in 30 days. Well, what does it say? I don't know. I just read the Bible. It doesn't do us any good to speed read through the Bible. It's just information at that point. But when we meditate on it, it could be a proverb. It could be a phrase. It could be a verse. It could be a story. But He says, meditate. It's not about reading it. It's actually sitting down and saying, wow, what does that mean to me? How does that impact my life? If I can speak it and I can meditate on it, then what I'll do is I'll just obey. Because the things that I learn, the things that I want, the things God wants to give to me is awesome. Joshua 23:14. At the end of his life, he says, soon I will die. Going the way of everything on earth. Deep in your hearts you know that every promise of the Lord, your God, has come true. Not a single one has failed. Joshua is saying you can trust God in everything that you do. So, if we're going to look at what God wants for our life, we need to speak it. We need to meditate on it, and we can obey it. But then, I truly believe we should test it. Your wilderness. the wondering that you have. You've been passed, been around Mount Sinai many times. Nobody knows the journey you're on. You do. The struggles that you face, the issues that you have, the immaturities that you possess, the wandering of your life. You say, man, I've done this too long. I'm tired of this. I'm tired of the wandering. I'm tired of the dry land. I'm tired of the thirst. I'm tired of the deja vu life. I want God's power. I want to have victory. I am tired. What do we do when we know that we're wandering around and we're hitting the brick wall? Something's got to change. Something needs to change. There's no joy in your life in the midst of sin. There's no peace in your life when you're wandering over and over again. The thing that we have to do is we have to go back to the kingdom part of your life. And we have to look and we have to possess the land. We have to go through your life and say, what is it that God wants for me? What is it that I have victory over? What is it that I have to fight? What is it that the struggles that I'm facing? What is the giant that's in front of me every day that I fail? And we have to name that giant, the issue that we are afraid of, the things that take a stronghold within our life that's causing us to circle and dry, thirsty desert every day, every week, every month, every year, and we're looking at failure. And a whole new generation is going to cross off the sink. And the next generation, my kids and your kids, are going to try to possess the land. The problem with it is your kids and my kids see our struggles. They see our wonders. They see our failures. What we have to do in order for them to have victory in their future, they must see us stand in the adversity of our future. We have to look at them and say, you know what, I do struggle in this area. I do have a problem here. I apologize. And I need your help to stand in the face of adversity, and I want to have victory because I want you, just like Joshua did, I want you to have success because God has promised something greater for me than any other thing that I could ever have. Oh, it's a fight. It's a battle. It's a struggle. But if I love my kids, the next generation, it is worth the fight today for them to have victory tomorrow. It is not our job to spend their future, to give to them nothing. There's a phrase that we say a lot, it's monkey see, monkey do. Our kids, the next generation, we need to give to them a spiritual heritage. The ability to understand the Word of God is true. Try something so audacious, so bold, in your wilderness experience that God's going to show up and you can stand up and say, God delivered me. You may be trying to quit smoking for 20 years, quit drinking, quit doing something crazy for 20 or 30 years and have failed and failed and failed and failed. Say, God, I need you. I need you now. And that testimony that you're going to have is I failed, but God delivered me. And the next generation will see that God is real. The next generation will see that God was needed. See, this generation, my generation, was taught from the past generation. In the past generation, they weren't necessarily emotional. There was not a lot of I love yous and I love yous and spent time spent. So my generation is a hiding generation. I don't want my kids to know that I don't have any money. I don't want my kids to know that I have failures. I don't want anybody to think that I have a problem. So my generation puts the facade on. We don't have family meetings and say, guys, there's no money spending this month. We've got $800 left in the bank account, and I've got car payment and this. So no, we don't do that to our kids. So what happens? They don't know that we have a problem. They don't know that we have issues. So they don't know when God does show up because we don't tell them we have a problem. What I need is I need to say, guys, let me tell you, I've been praying about this. This is what God needs to do within my life, and I have an issue here. We need this, and we need that. Can we pray? Can we pray as a family that we have this, and that we need that? And then when our generation sees that my generation humbled themselves and sought after God and prayed, and God delivered, I can stand up and say, I would not have had this if I didn't ask God for it. I would have never been delivered if God didn't deliver it. If our kids, the next generation, does not see that we need God, they will not see God. It's our choice. From Moses to Joshua, the generation. Let us challenge and need God to be courageous, to stand firm, never, never, never to give ground. Look at those strongholds and say, I will not be defeated. It's your call. He is your God. We are called by His name. As Moses says, deliver my people. God is our Lord, He's our Father, and He's our Savior. You are His church. Let's stand and be the church. Dear Father, Lord, we love you. And Lord, over these next 4 or 5 weeks, I pray that we can learn how to be strong. How we can take back the enemy's stronghold within our life. To look at our addictions and our issues within our life and say, this is what I need God to do, and I pray. I humbly get before God and pray that He gives me the strength and the courage to occupy that spiritual territory, that I am not in bondage any longer. I have been delivered, and I don't have to wonder in immaturity, that I can stand in the promised land that God has given to me. And I pray, Lord, in our spiritual life, in our church, in our homes, that we do what you called us to do, to listen, to speak, to meditate, and to do the very words of God. Amen. In Jesus' name.